follows the path of egalitarianism in the teachings and movements of the shamanic leadership beginning with Buddha to the contemporaries. Presently, he is a fellow in Indian Institute of Advanced Studies, Shimla. I request Professor Mr. Braj Ranjan to come forward and offer his advice.
I am deeply grateful to Dr. Gopinath sir and his many worthy colleagues for organizing this seminar on historical materialism in India. In this presentation, I would like to underline the long-standing Brahmanic control over our knowledge, how this knowledge dominance has been established historically and intellectually from ancient times to the contemporary one, and how this knowledge is deeply aligned with power, and how this knowledge power nexus have not allowed historical materialism in India to emerge. This presentation is a very pared down, a very shortened version of a very long paper I have already done, and it's in continuation of my two works, The Brahmanizing History and Knowledge and Power. Knowledge as a form of power is not as manifest as to other forms of power, political and economic. But the exercise of power perpetually creates knowledge, and knowledge constantly induces effects of power. The sociology of knowledge helps us grasp the affinity between thought models and the social position of given groups. In India, this problem is particularly pernicious due to the long-standing Brahmanic control over knowledge. Despite some challenging attempts from below from time to time, and especially in recent times, production and transmission of institutionalized knowledge remains in custody of caste elites. And we should be very emphatic about it, in recognition of this theme of reproduction and transmission of knowledge is still being confined to caste elites. The caste elites who share a similar mental framework, even though they have a variety of outlooks. This applies to the whole intellectual growth that reproduces India's history and culture in many devious ways. The lure to derive pleasure and profit from such misrepresentation is so great that many secular leftist intellectuals, late among the celebrators of myths, tradition and religion, fervently suppress inconvenient historical and contemporary reality. This explains the absence of any fundamental questioning of the intellectual violence of Brahmanism, normalization, essentialization of caste, the identification of Vedic Aryan culture with Indian culture, and the constant secular as well as religious fabrications to legitimize the ideology of the powerful. In the 19th century, stressing this knowledge power nexus, Jyotirao Phule had denounced the traditional custodians of knowledge as kalam kasai, pain wielding butchers. And in the next century, three, four decades down the line, Ambedkar was compelled to say that he was the only non-Brahman scholar of his time. Phule and Ambedkar had rightly traced the roots of cumulative dominance and cumulative demoralization in the historical exclusion of the lower caste from the realm of education and its manifold consequences. The fact is, the lower castes were not allowed even to imbibe the canonical dominant knowledge and their own organic knowledge evolved through experience was unrecognized, even stigmatized, preventing the possibility of an alternate knowledge system emerging. This has been the real tragedy of India, and this tragedy isn't even recognized by the dominant academia. In fact, the tendency to see social world as a hierarchy, not as a circle in which all of us live, has been induced by a long tradition of fabricated knowledge in India and elsewhere. Such fabrication has historically been crucial in the construction and reproduction of hierarchies, and when such Brahmanization of knowledge is complete, it becomes easier for the ruling forces to pull the world over people's eyes and present myth as history, precluding any clear-cut stock-taking of past and present. This is exactly what is happening in India today, and this paper, I hope, may help us a bit in grasping the deeper historical factors that lie behind the seemingly irrepressible rise of the Hindu rights. And with this, I would like to very briefly touch upon the intellectual foundation of social hierarchies in India and in other societies or other countries. But I would just skip this part because I would like to highlight on issues specific to Indian situation. But briefly, as all of us know, in the 16th century, it was in the 16th century when Francis Bacon famously equated knowledge with power. And centuries before Bacon, Plato had visualized the republic ruled by philosophers. And it was a republic of caste, actually. I have written a great deal about it in my new book. I'm not going to, I don't have time to explain it here. But even before Plato, the anonymous Brahmin literati in India had propounded the concept of Shabd Brahma. Shabd is, word is all powerful. You know, it's the phrase for letters in Hindi or Sanskrit is akshar, something which cannot be destroyed. And Shabd Brahma, you can, there cannot be a greater exaltation, a greater glorification of words than this. Singing the glory of words, the Brahmins monopolized this Shabd Shakti and made this their ultimate weapon, Brahmastra, to subjugate the whole of society in a caste mode in which everything was rigged in their favor. All this was done on the strength of knowledge, the knowledge that blurred the boundary between religious and secular, faith and reason, hierarchy and harmony, and the sole goal was power by hook or by crook. Under this system of knowledge, justice became hierarchy and inequality, and it was given a religious spiritual gloss, and it was made the bedrock of religion and culture created on caste. How did this Veda, Dharma or caste canon nexus take place? I would like to give a very brief account of this here. How the Brahmanic canon and caste construction are deeply, deeply intertwined. The champions of Vedas and Chaturvarya claim that Vaidiki Hinsa Hinsa Na Bhavati. It's Vedic violence is no violence. It's not my phrase. This eloquent phrase had been used by ancient Brahmin literati. And this Vedic violence was institutionalized in the system of caste, which was essentially a religious hierarchy that also encompassed the political and the social, as Disa has said in his famous work, and as Dr. Ambedkar did in his own way. Caste thus was also an intellectual and moral construct, beginning with its naturalization, sacralization in the Purushup of the Rig Veda. Let's see the basic framework of this canon caste nexus. The classical Brahminical ideal of knowledge is sublimation of self, Atman, for attaining the supreme self, Brahman. But in real life, it implies performing predetermined past duties for attaining salvation from ignorance or illusion. In this way, the theory of knowledge and the practice of that theory are committed to uphold past ideology. As a scholar says, his name is Poromesh Acharya, there is sanction of the caste system in the ideology of knowledge itself. Unquote. The scriptural Brahmanic texts advance the idea that Varnas are real universals rooted in the original Vedic ontological makeup of humankind. The Vedic past as a model of timeless past, truth, is credited with epistemological power of all knowledge. According to Mimamsa interpretation, Shruti, that literally means heard, and Smriti, that's remember, things or events remember, both refer to Veda, which is also the Sanskrit word for knowledge, from the root word Ved, that's to know, so Veda means knowledge. Smriti is so-called remembering ancient pre-existing truth. This knowledge was out there merely to be discovered, and such knowledge, it was believed, had already been discovered by the older sages and gurus, and this gave birth to the concept that knowledge should be transmitted only as a gift, only as a present, from the all-knowing guru to the docile disciple, which paved the path to Guru Shishya Parampara. This axiom on which such knowledge production rested was, and I am quoting here Sheldon Pollack, that the improvement of any given practice lies not in the future of the discovery of what has never been known before, but in the past and the more complete recovery of what was known in full in the past. Unquote. Not for nothing, the Sanskrit word for education is Shiksha. Shiksha is one of the six Vedans or integral parts of Veda. Literally, Shiksha means learning or practice. And the Sanskrit word for study is Adhyayan, whose etymological meaning is to utter or recite, and hence to hear it also. So the whole emphasis was on not thinking afresh, but to get something that was available and existing in the past, discovered by earlier sages and thinkers. This whole knowledge construction was embedded in variously bolstering the ideology of caste as well. Thus, the past was continuously invented and kept alive by the present. The practical function of this process was to establish a flexible source of epistemological authority for perpetuating caste hierarchy and Brahmanic supremacy of our society. This way, far from being an agent of change, the knowledge construction was committed to uphold the caste fundamentalism. The texts constantly refer to rules in still earlier texts and never problematize the relation between the norms of the past and actual contemporary practices. In this way, the Brahman literati recreated every day the social world and its species of varnas and jatis together with their inherent caste characteristics. But this Brahmanic line of thinking didn't go unopposed. In the first millennium before Common Era, There were several schools of thoughts led by Shramanas who believed in universal egalitarian ethics that radically differed from the tendency to segment religious practice by caste, which was characteristic of Brahminism. It was from this intellectually fecund community that Buddhism and Jainism arose and posed the challenge to the Brahmanic authority and normative prescriptions, dismissing the Vedic metaphysics, karma kams, and the concept of caste as a divine phenomenon. The Brahmins saw the threat to the Veda as a threat to their social supremacy. If the masses accepted such views, they feared their mission to build a culture of caste would collapse. The Brahmins therefore came forward with a bewildering range of Gyan Srijan or Shastra Rachana, canon construction, to defend their hierarchical worldview. In this running battle with the contesting ideologies, they erected defense after defense to reinforce the theory and practice of caste hierarchy. Evidence of this attempt at caste reinforcement can be seen in Dharma Sutras first and later Dharma Shastras, enjoining each member of society to strictly adhere to his or her caste and gender duties. And then the ritual and metaphysical fundamentals of Vedic worldview were bolstered through developing the six specialisms of Vedic knowledge known as Vedanga. At the metaphysical level, support for caste was carried in the Vedanta or Upanishadic philosophy. Through a fine maze of metaphysical conceptions, the Upanishads basically tried to discover some unchanging eternal reality behind all the illusion of changing phenomenon of the world. The quest for the absolute led to the concept of an eternal soul and its eternal creator. Such absolutism, along with the theory of karma, was used to defend the human hierarchy as divinely designed. Similarly, the tendency to reinforce caste is vividly evident in the linguistic domain. It is striking that the preservation of language sounds, varnamala, that grammar achieves, was linked essentially to preservation of caste order, varna vyavastha. The link between varnamala, its alphabets, and varna vyavastha, caste-based society. In fact, the Sanskrit language was employed as a veritable cultural weapon to establish caste order, and there was ontological linkage between the order of language and the order of society. The Hindi word for it is shabdanushasan, and anushasan in samaj, the linkage between the two. This linkage between the two, which is manifest from the fact that the preservation of language sounds and the preservation of social orders are expressed by the same phrase, same words, varna sthiti, as Sheldon Pollock shows in his major work, The Language of the Gods in the World of Men. Pollock says, powers concerned with grammar and to a comparable degree grammars concerned with power comprised a constitutive feature of the Sanskrit cosmopolitan order, unquote. Through the correspondence between language and social control is not exclusive, not unique to Brahminism or to India, but the extent and depth of its pervasiveness remains unparalleled. As Ranjit Guha says in his famous work on Persian insurgency, that vak parushyam, sublimation of violence in language, vak is a speech in Sanskrit, vak parushyam is violence of words and its exaltation, sublimation of violence is in language, is the defining feature of some of the most ancient and sacred Sanskrit texts. Guha points out that the ideology of caste molded the very grammar of Sanskrit in its own image. A grand rule of Panini's grammar, for example, can be interpreted in such a way as to make the caste hierarchy itself in a compound of dwand, samasas, class, and put them together in their ascriptive order descending from Brahman to Shudra. What was sought to be controlled was not the spoken word alone, but also the zero sign of utterance, that is, silence used formally and yet eloquently enough as a significant absence of speech. The Brahmanic ban on various kinds of conversation could announce the subordination of junior thing to senior, of wife to husband, of low caste to high caste, and generally of the underclass to the elite. Guha has given several vivid examples from 19th century India, ranging from south to north to illustrate this point. He cites several sociological studies of the 19th century that shows the terrible linguistic imposition of domination and subordination in quotidian life. Such vicious hierarchization in the everyday speech was clearly connected to classical vocabulary of Sanskrit, as many of its key words served for caste markers. For example, the Sanskrit expression for excellence is utkrishtata, derived from utkrisht, which literally means high born. Like the common word for a work that is contemptible is nikrishtata, from nikrisht, literally low born. And these words are often used, I'm a Hindi speaking guy and I can vouch for that. Similarly, the word Shudra is derived from idol Shudra, whose literal meaning is contemptible, without any worth or value. Thus the leitmotifs, the major theme and common strands woven intricately through the knowledge system, both religious and philosophical, was the defense of caste hierarchy and Brahmins wielded knowledge as a social and psychological weapon to colonize the minds and bodies of the lower castes and women. So, proclaiming Jnanam Amritam, knowledge is nectar, is life giving thing, and Shabd Dham Hai, and knowing that those who control the words, control the world, they position themselves to be in the exclusive custody of words. Manu says, and he quotes him, and it's very well known, speech is the Brahman's weapon, and with that he should strike down his enemies, unquote. But even a more devastating one is by Kautilya, and I would like to quote it. I spent long time finding it in the original text, and after 3-4 years I got it. I'm giving you the English translation of it, and I think it's a poem worth remembering. Bring out the darkest side of knowledge, which often remains obscure from our view. The moment the word knowledge, vidya, education, knowledge, construction comes, we become very emotional. We think that it will lead us to lies, to light, it will give us life. But actually, if knowledge has always been a double-edged sword, and it has been used for nefarious, destructive things, actually more often than for enhancing life. And here he is saying, the arrow shot by an archer may or may not kill a single man, but the stratagems devised by a vipra or Brahmin can kill even babes in the womb, unquote. And I think
if you get the gist of it, it explains almost everything. How, you know, the caste system, when the Brahmins, you know, came up with caste construction, it was not a reality at the time. It was more a prescription for society than the description of the existing reality. But, you know, if we see things today, what was their fantasy, what they wanted to achieve, actually they had. And this devastating quote from Kautilya actually explains it. Millions of children, innocent children, are being killed by the caste system. You know, the killing is not just by slashing someone's throat, but it can also be done by denying the very fundamentals of life, you know, the basic nutrition, education, and things that enable us to lead a good life, good and constructive life. So, the important thing is, Manu and Kautilya, they are not just individuals. They represented the mindset of intellectual violence. Manu, as you know, world is a smriti, na shudraya mati gadya. Do not give knowledge to shudras. And na istri swatantra marjati, do not give freedom to women under any conditions. The Brahmanic texts constantly stress that Shudras and women have no place in the world of knowledge. The punishment to a Shudra for reading or hearing the Vedas or other sacred literature was brutal and barbaric. And this was justified by the Varna Dharma with its fundamental assertion that various castes and genders have different essences and so they deserve differential treatment. This is essentially a racist, sexist ideology which was given a moral halo and religious gloss under what is known as Varnashram Dharma. Thus, since the days of the first canon construction in India, the dominant knowledge production here has been at loggerheads with humanity and dignity of the common people. The text and their context leave little doubt that they are actually a manifesto of a caste-based hierarchy and exclusion. Relentless religious propaganda indoctrinated the people with the values of caste and patriarchy, forcing them, often with political coercion and psychological manipulation, to internalize self-oppressive norms and values. Slavery is inborn in Shudras and women. This is a common refrain in the religious texts. And to validate and normalize such slavery, the literati employed everything from divine discourse to profane arguments. Now, I will try to briefly show how the Indian mind was closed through prioritizing mythography over historiography. And this perhaps will help us understand a bit about the lack of historical materialism in India, why it didn't even emerge, and we are still struggling for it, and rather unsuccessfully. So how the closing of Indian mind was done? Through prioritizing mythography over historiography. As the past influences the present in many ways, the animated debate about history never comes to an end. Some pertinent points about myth and history can help us better understand India's troubled past and present. Obviously, myth is not history. Myth making, though, is not exclusive to India. But the problem here is peculiar and very deep. The ancient India has only mythography in the form of itihas pura. Why didn't historical mindedness develop in India? The fact that the study of history flourished in other countries such as ancient Greece and China, but not in India, is not accidental. It's not fortuitous that
historical mindedness didn't develop in India. It seems that the choice of mythography was deliberate and a crucial part of the Brahmanic strategy to suppress and misrepresent the historical events. All societies, as we know, have undergone and experienced some form of hierarchy, especially in the past, and that past has not yet become a past. But as Bernard Brown underlines in an important work, the degree of hierarchy is not the same in every society. Less hierarchical societies tend to be more open and inclusive, with more avenues and scope for social mobility. Whereas rigidly hierarchical societies like India's are by and large closed, who are only those from previous families and castes are able to get ahead. In more open societies, success depends in a large measure on an individual's skills and initiatives, giving rise to an interest in history as a repository of facts and interpretations about why certain individuals succeeded and others didn't. Open societies have a propensity to be interested in accurate recording of chronology, biography, and realistic portraiture, as well as common educational philosophy, social and political science, the pace and direction of change, and above all, a belief in the idea of universality of human nature. By contrast, closed societies, of which pre-modern India is a model or prototype, tend to represent individuals symbolically, identifying persons through the symbols of their caste or gender or rank, rather than depicting their individual characteristics. In producing images, art and literature that are highly stylized and symbolic, the objective of the ruling class, ruling castes in the case of India, in closed societies like ours, is to perpetuate illusions and mystification about society, thus keeping people away from the historical reality. For this reason, the caste elites elevated myths over historical facts, hagiography, huzurography over biography, symbolism over realism, superstition over science, fate over free will, and above all, education of the few over education of the many. Which is why the pandits wrote only Itihas Puran, which, unlike historical narratives, are a make-believe account that conceals the reality far more than they reveal. By mixing the natural with the supernatural and fact with fiction, myths allow us to read whatever we like to read. If a society is left only with myths, it will be well nigh impossible to grasp the past. This, however, was the precise purpose of the pundits, to hide or suppress as far as possible the evidence of real evidence so that real history could not be understood. This explains why did the caste elites fictionalize their own and the larger social history. The very origin of caste was explained through a myth in the Rig Veda. To base the origin of caste on a supernatural agency and fictitious claims of descent from mythic figures and other mythifications were essential for keeping the people in the dark about how they were enslaved in the caste system. The pundits who wrote misleading accounts kept even their own identities hidden from the public eye. It is striking that most Brahmanic works remain either anonymous or attributed to fictitious authors. Manu, for example, is not the real name of the man who wrote Manusmriti, and no one knows whether Kautilya was a historical figure or just a straw man. By filling the public space with misleading stories and legends, by blurring the difference between myth and reality, the pundits destroyed the very possibility of any meaningful discussion about society and its actual functioning. In many of the Puranas, statements about events were made in the future tense, although they were written much after the events had happened. And this is a general pattern of Puranas. If you read Puranas, you will see accounts of the future not just the past or present. Those events, those things have happened, in the past. Similar falsification, mystification are evident in the Dharma Shastras, the Sanskritized epics of the Ramayana and Mahabharata. Yesterday we were discussing the epics, Ramayana and Mahabharata. The important thing to remember about those epics is that there are Ramayans and Ramayans, Mahabharats and Mahabharats, and what are now commonly recognized as Ramayana and Mahabharata actually far from the original stories and legends, which he tested with the Brahmanic sort of didactism. And that's almost a total distortion of the original story. There were some accounts of the past and some accounts of the narrative stories give us the glimpse of the past as it would have been. But it's fundamentally distorted by the introduction of frequent teaching of Brahmanic values. And not just epics, Ramayana and Mahabharata, but also other sacerdotal, other priestly texts. The general design is to confine Brahmanic prescription with social description. So, fraudulently was fiction interwoven with selective facts that the Buddhist shamanic counter traditions were erased, suppressed, or at the best grossly misrepresented in some fleeting references. A Puranic text depicts Ashoka as a hated Buddhist and a despised Shudra. And Mauryas, the dynasty to which she belonged, were dismissed as Shudra Prayastala or Dharmika. It means mainly Shudras and unrighteous. There were numerous instances, and I'm not quoting that. Some of the illustrations can be found in my book, Knowledge and Power. And later I have updated it in my new book, Knowledge and Power. So I gave you just a taste, a glimpse of it here, giving an example or two. Ashoka, in fact, had to be discovered in the 19th century on the basis of his rock edicts and the Ceylonese chronicles. And Ashoka's icon, Gautam Buddha, fared no better as well. As the Brahmanic forces tried to destroy Buddhism through a conspiracy that stretched our century. Actually, in the middle of 19th century, there was debate here in India among historians, upcoming historians, and also globally, because Buddha by that time was recognized as a major world figure. But there was a debate whether he was a historical figure or not, whether he was Indian or not, because there had been no trace of him historically. Those things were still to be dug out, and if you those things were done in subsequent decades. It was only by the end of the 19th century that we came to know about the basic events and chronology surrounding Gautam Buddha. The Sanskrit literati didn't keep any records and chronologies, and they also tried to destroy the records and literature of their adversaries, and sadly they succeeded to a great extent in that. They indulged in large-scale forgeries to recast Indian culture in the Brahmanic mold. They suppressed facts, changed names, confused places and periods, proffered false data, created fictitious dynastic pedigrees, and for a fee, frequently reevaluated and tampered with their Vedas and Puranas, Sanskritized the epics, Mahabharata and Ramayana, and above all, brutally censored all additional voices and events. And this is what it's happening today. And when we you know, read ancient past creatively and substantially, it gives an insight why the things are as they are here and why things are happening the way they are unfolding today. And as power politics was at the heart of their knowledge production, they promoted massive ignorance and prohibited any learning for the lower castes and women. And lower caste here, by lower caste I mean not just 20-30 population, it encompasses absolute majority of Indian people, 70-80%. Dalit, what we call Dalit communities, and OBCs, and other subjugated subaltern communities. So more than 80%. And if we take women into account, it's well over 95%. But most scholars and Sanskritists, both Indian and Western, not only hide this reality but also glorify what was essentially an ugly and oppressive tradition. When they describe Brahminism or Hinduism, real history evaporates, actual meanings in the Sanskrit texts are marginalized or muted, and what one gets is a distilled, idealized version of Brahmanic religion and social order. With amazing verbal jugglery and sophistication, the Brahmanic works are held up as a model of glorious ethics and intellectualism. Its open advocacy of social discrimination is usually drowned in fantastic elaboration of some stray ethical words, didactic phrase, or abstract philosophical proposition. I will give a major example. The Vedantic metaphysical unity of Atman with Brahman is celebrated as the splendid spirituality without bothering to grasp how such ideals were interpreted in the real world, where extreme social cruelties and corruption festered just beneath this veneer of the sublime or the spiritual. The fact that in order to identify Atman or Brahman, Atman has to be separated from the empirical self betrays the utter irrelevance of such ideals in real life. All this is hocus pocus, it doesn't mean anything. On other side, the anti-caste forces, despite the resistance offered by Buddhism and a long tradition of continuous social protest, failed to produce an effective line of scholars who could take on the Brahmanic knowledge system. The early intellectual lead that Brahminism established over its challenges continued in the medieval and colonial period, despite some setbacks here and there. For example, Akbar's court was blessed with many pundits, and even an Upanishad was concocted in the Mughal period. And when the British came, the caste elites colluded with them and became their main interlocutors. And colonialism was nothing but coming together of British ruling class and the privileged sections of Indians, especially Brahmins and allied castes. In the last section, I will try to show how caste elites knew intellectualism, modern knowledge construction, hides the deeper historical and contemporary reality. So there is no break, decisive break from the tradition we saw a glimpse of earlier. This is continuing, and how I will try to illustrate how this is continuing through giving some examples from some of the most renowned modern works and their major propositions. With the establishment of modern education system in the 1850s, the caste elites surged forward and reclaimed their rights as natural leaders of society. Before the birth of Ambedkar, he was the first Dalit matriculate. There were 20,000 matriculates in India, mainly from Brahmin and allied castes. And after the 90s, actually, more and more people were getting into the school system and were appearing for final high school exams and becoming matriculates. So by the time Ambedkar, the first Dalit matriculate from this subcontinent, and I'm saying this because at the time Pakistan, Bangladesh, Burma was also part of India. He was the first, and in those parts also there is substantial Dalit population, especially in Bangladesh and Pakistan. And he was the first Dalit matriculate, and 1907. And by the time, I think, I don't have the number, but there must have been around 100,000 matriculates. And we can imagine, who these people were. Thus, despite the challenges from Dalit Bahujans, led by rebels like Mahatma Phule and Periyar and Ambedkar, caste elites emerged as a new intellectual class in India. This intellectual hegemony and the modernization of the Brahmanic mind has not yet been recognized, let alone challenged. India, since independence, is a democracy, and its constitutional mandate is inclusive egalitarian. But it also has a millennia old discriminatory ethos of caste. Baba Sahib made a majestic speech in 1948 at the Constituent Assembly, where he is saying that now we are becoming a democracy, but it's a very superficial thing, because it's only the top soil of the top layer of the Indian soil, which is deeply inequality, inequality. So he is saying how we will be a democracy in form, but will be a long, long struggle to become an actual democracy, because it has a millennia old tradition. November 25, 1949, in which he talks about the life of contradictions we are going to enter. We will be a republic, we will be a democracy, but we will be a deeply unequal society. Unless we base that, we are in deep trouble. One major reason for the failure of democracy to solve the social problems in India is the reproduction of culture and knowledge in the Brahmanic mode. Multiplicity of voices and competing visions of India apart, the politics of dominance brings the privileged groups together in various rightist, liberal and leftist camps. Even though they have a variety of outlooks, they agree on the myth of India as a remarkably open and non-violent society. They variously envision a more or less problem-free past and pending the idea of a Hinduism that comes very close to the obscurantist valorization of caste and Brahminism. It seems as if the entire burden of reproduction of knowledge about India is to somehow converge on one or other kind of Brahmanic conclusion, and thus to variously discredit and destroy the Dalit Bahujans' memory of their oppressive past and their own lived experiences of caste and discrimination in contemporary time. The constant reinvention of old and modern myths of both religious and secular variety explains the absence of any fundamental questioning of caste and Brahminism. If you are critical of caste and Brahminism, you are Eurocentric and guilty of the denigration of civilizational ethos of India. Any suggestion that caste and race, Brahminism and colonialism, or dislocation is still heresy. Wonderful queries, rich in erudition and documentation, such as caste is a colonial construction, almost a fabrication of the population surveys and census reports, and that's the gist of the works of Ronald Newman and Nicholas Dutz. Communalism is an Orientalist term produced as a form of colonialist knowledge. This is the gist of G. Pandey's very critically acclaimed work on communalism. Secularism constitutes an alien cultural ideology. And I'm putting this phrase, alien cultural ideology, in quotes, and a gift of Christianity. And again, in quotes, there are no fundamentalists or revivalists in traditional society. This is still modern. These things are being invented under the banner of post-coloniality of the indigenous
to justify and defend the innocence which confronted modern Western colonialism. Unquote. Nothing can be further from these propositions. The innocence here involves the innocence here involves the complete erasure of centuries of intellectual fraud and violence of caste and patriarchy. In other words, the colonial tragedy returning now as the post-colonial past
allows the elite to mystify the caste gender exploitation and masquerade themselves as oppressed rather than the oppressors. In the words of Ezaz Ahmed, and he puts it very mildly, but I think very eloquently, and I am quoting him, colonialism is now held responsible not only for its own cruelties, but conveniently enough for ours too. Unquote. The influence that interests still exert over all channels of communication, from the elite academia to mass media, ensures a perpetual ambience of brainwashing. Invented stories and stereotypes merge seamlessly to create convenient narratives and myths that are sold as history of India. As the Brahmanic myths about India penetrated beyond the borders of India in modern times, the empty cant of Brahminism that hides now behind the Hydra-headed facade of Hinduism and Hindutva persists in multifarious forms. The obscurantist notions about India, such as Hinduism being 5 millennia old, Vedanta containing the ultimate truths, and encompassing the answer to most complex challenges to humanity, Indian culture being inherently tolerant and peaceful, and being emotionally alert to fellow beings, and caste and cares which cares far more for women and family than other societies and cultures, Hinduism alone being capable of producing an apostle of peace and non-violence like Gandhi, and is thus the culmination of the cultural evolution of mankind, are taken seriously not only by an army of illiterates but also by august gatherings of academics. It seems there is an intriguing link between the political Hinduism of the semi-literate vulgar fanatics who demand that the past and present of India be constituted around Hinduism, and the Brahmanic Hinduism of the academic study that we find in the writings of the scholars who are in command of epistemology, erudition and classical tradition. Actually, there is a deep alignment between the Bajrangbalis and RSS goons on the streets and the greatest of our scholars. The language and idiom is different, but actually they are saying the same thing. And this I have been trying to show, though not very elaborately, but I'm working on it. I'm giving you a pared down version. It's a very shorter version of what I have already done. So, and this is the reality. Actually, we can talk about it and think from there. We should be able to first see things as they are which will enable us to deal with that, more creatively in order to democratize our society. Whenever there is cognizance of some problematic things, social operations, they are finally wrapped in explanations produced by masters in the art of explaining the way. Those things will be explained away beautifully, and sometimes they will recognize that, you know, there has been some problems and you know, discrimination and oppression, etc. Even those who accept the injustices of caste hasten to add the pointlessness of raking them up as if those things and their consequences have become history or have already taken care of. But the suppressed story murders the lies. This is why the stories of Eklavya and Shambhuka and Sita shouldn't be forgotten. Symbolic characters like them are few in the epics, but there must have been millions in real life. Above all, their descendants have barely risen above the struggle for survival, and they constitute 2/3 of India's population. That is why the distorted history and culture should be countered wherever we encounter it, with the understanding that the master's tools will not dismantle the master's house. This, however, is extremely challenging as the Dalit Bahujans continue to be demoralized and more or less still absent from the process of production and transmission of knowledge. Yet, for a just and inclusive change, it is necessary to wage a sustained cultural and intellectual struggle against the hierarchical worldview and replace them with an inclusive one. The youngsters who read in their history books of Dronacharya's brilliance as a teacher and Kautilya's superb statecraft should also be told that those men were perfidious by any ethical standards. The depiction of Hindu dharma as an indigenous way of dispensing justice shouldn't conceal its exclusionary norms that suppress Dalit Bahujans and women. Hagiographical accounts of Gandhi's humbug and homilies shouldn't omit his fond support for caste and Brahminism. Our history is replete with spectacular faults of the good and the great. Perhaps it would do the resilient Indian psyche more damage if the false gods are a little mocked, if the great foundation of lies on which our civilization rests are a little uncertain, if the continual glorification of Ved, Puran and Hindu culture is at least a little counterbalanced by some knowledge of how Brahmanic social order was constituted and evolved, and how there has been a long and deep contestation against it from the days of the Buddha to the present. Thank you very much.
Is it just ontological or phenomenological or epistemological change? Or all together, whether to in order to animate or in order to suppress the caste system, whether it should change the structure of phenomenology or ontology or epistemology. I was just going to the last stage, so you mentioned certain points. So my question is,
Actually, I think yours is a rhetorical question, and you gave answers to the queries you raised. It should be an all-encompassing struggle. That was the focus of my presentation. You know, it should be an intellectual struggle. It should be a social struggle, struggle on the streets, and in the language. It's intellectual. It encompasses everything. I'm eschewing the word epistemological a bit, and making it simpler by putting it just intellectual. Mm-hmm. So it includes philosophical, epistemological, as I was trying to do a little bit.
But it must be aligned with the larger social struggle, and only then, yes.
So whether the technological domination of Varnashrama system, we will have to have like any counter epistemology for that instance. So, for instance, like I would term it epistemicide, like genocide,
yes.
Quickicide, infanticide. We need to also grab certain things in order to counter the episteme, like new kind of set of rules, new kind of curriculum and entire epistemic side altogether. So that work, that work is going on, but still epistemic side should happen in various layers of the society. On drawn grassroots level to the philosophical conceptual level. I think there should be
some
epistemic side on the
parametric
system.
Yeah, you are going too far too soon. The need first is to recognize this intellectual violence, epistemic violence. You know, when we do that, we will come forward with something to counter it effectively. And there has been a tradition of that, but to make it hegemonic is the real challenge. Despite all the contestations, Brahmanic knowledge system has been hegemonic, you know, and till today. So, you know, the burden is the challenge before us, how to do it. And we all are trying to do our bits, but we should also recognize that this is not enough, and we should be restless for that, and we should open our minds, our imagination, perhaps a little more, and continue doing that, unless we are able to subdue the dominant epistemology. Yeah.
Okay. Anybody else? I saw some other hand there.
Do you have a question, sir? Anybody? Yeah, so Mike here. So there are two main questions I hear. Professor Alexis is here, and that's all. Next, you see.
Thanks, Mani, and your information base is astounding. And it's a pleasure to listen to you from the Sanskrit days.
I have learned everything from you.
It's a beautiful thing. But one thing I would like to comment, which I think maybe just an oversight. We are so engrossed with the overwhelming dominance of this grammatical reality. And it almost sort of, you know, coincides with what we call India. When you make a statement sort of passing like that, you know, India doesn't have any historical tendencies, historical instinct and so on, we are referring to the dominant grammatical tendency within the country. And if we are not able to project the other side, I think this is our problem. We are not done that sufficiently. If there has been mythological thing, there has been a historiographic effort also. If there is a kind of illusory kind of research going on, it's also an empirical research. Okay. I mean, what we see, you were talking on the Brahmanism. Brahmanism is defeated and gone, but a lot of Brahmanism is posing an alternate epistemological and also anthropological questions. And they have gone very deeply into the psyche of what today you consider lower class and so on, and in their problems, in their rituals and so on and so forth. I think we intellectuals have failed to project it adequately, so that the overwhelming presence of Brahminism hides the thing that we surrender to the thing that India is like. India is not like. I think you have to answer the bank, but in raising it and cooperating it, that we should do it with capital.
I think it's a very deep and very genuine interjection. and I would like to think about it. And of course, our efforts are very, very inadequate.